this, this lens. What is this? This is what? Aperture. That is its aperture. Okay, a lens will look like a, you know, circular thing. Have you seen lens? Have you ever burned a piece of paper using lens? Right, so it's a circular thing. Okay, usually. What is this? This is principal axis, okay? But how you will construct the principal axis? What is the method of identifying principal axis? What it is? You have two radius of curvature. Suppose this is made up of a sphere of radius R1 and that is made up of sphere of radius R2. Okay? So, you can say that this is a part of this sphere and this surface is a part of that sphere. Are you getting it? Okay, so radius of curvature of that is R1, sorry, R2 is for this. So center of curvature is suppose here. So this is, let us say C2. Okay, and for this surface, center of curvature is suppose here. This is C1, let us say. This is C1, that is C2. Okay, so a line which joins both the center of curvatures is principal axis. Any doubt on this? Okay. What we call this point as? This is optical center. Okay? Fine. Suppose here refractive index is mu1. Okay? Here also we will assume it to be mu1. And inside the lens, let us say refractive index is mu2. Any doubt till now? What is this distance? Achha, does it matter whether I take this distance, that distance, or this distance? Does it matter?
No.
No, because our assumption is it's a thin lens. It's like a straight line. Okay? So, whenever I am measuring horizontal distance along the principal axis, I just need to touch one of the points of the lens. Okay? This distance is what? R1 or R2?
R1.
No, this is R2. This center of curvature is for this radius. You're getting it? Okay? And this one will be R1. Fine. Is there anything that defines the situation? Anything else that you think of? Yeah, I mean, what can affect the light other than these? No, focus can be derived. Can focus be derived out of these things? So a light that comes suppose parallel to it, how much it will deviate, does it depend on only these, yes or no? Right, there is no other optical thing or nothing can affect other than these variables. Okay, so whatever you have written here, they are geometrical or optical parameters that are the causes of deflection. So these are the causes. What are the causes? R1, R2, mu1, mu2. Okay, these are the cause. And effect is what? What is the effect because of this? Deflection of light. The path of the light changes. Fine. So the effect is deviation. Fine. Are you getting it? Now, different kinds of rays will undergo different kinds of deviation. Are you getting? But I need to find out a unique type of deviation which I can say, okay, this is how much powerful this lens is. This is how much it can deviate. So you need to choose a particular type of ray which it will deviate by some amount. So what should that ray be? Parallel to the principal axis. Right? So just like our convention in case of mirror was that you consider the parallel rays to be special ones and see where it will intersect, and that becomes a focal point. Here also, when we talk about how powerful or what is the effect of the lens, we consider parallel rays. What happens to the parallel ray? Okay. So what happens to the parallel ray? It will deviate, and this is the amount of deviation. Yes or no? This is the deviation, right? So if this distance is less, can I say distance is, so can I say deviation is more?
Yeah.
Right? So I will track this distance. This is also called focus or focal length. Are you getting it? Fine. So the deviation can be quantified in terms of F. How much is the focal length? Are you getting it? Okay. So you know what is the focal length? We already discussed about it. As in, focal length is a distance of a point where parallel rays, parallel to the principal axis, will meet the principal axis. Isn't it? That point distance from the optical center here. Okay, actually what I am doing, I am stating the obvious things in a more elaborate way. Are you getting what I am saying? Okay, so let us try to find out how much is the focal length in terms of mu1, mu2 and r1 and r2. Okay, so you have a spherical interface formula with you, yes or no? So try to use that to find out where these parallel ray of lines will hit the principal axis. So basically what you are doing, you are trying to find image of an object which is kept at infinity. Okay, find objects, find the location of image, that is your focal length. Okay, try to do this. See, first you use spherical interface formula between, sorry, for the first interface between mu1 and mu2, then you use that second interface to find the next image for location. So let us say for interface 1, you have this interface formula n2 by v minus n1 by u equals to n2 minus n1 by r. Tell me what is the value of n2 for this interface. This is the first interface. What is n2? N2 is mu2, right? So this is mu2 divided by, I don't know where is the image, so let us say v1. Minus n1 is what? Mu1, u is what? Infinity. So I'll put infinity here. This is equal to mu2 minus mu1 divided by r1. Is this in clear? Clear? Now what will happen for the second interface? Write down for interface 2. Where is the object for second interface? What is u for the interface? Second. V1. Because second interface will feel as if light is coming from V1. Why? Because the image of the first interface is what the second interface will see. Okay? But what observer is seeing here is what is the image after second interface. Are you getting the point? Observer sees what is the image after second interface, but second interface sees the image of first interface. So image of first interface is the object of second interface. Okay? And what is n2 for the second interface? Mu1. Good. So this is mu1 by v is what? Let us take it as v only, because that is the final image, minus n2 is mu2 now. Sorry, n1 is mu2 now. Mu2 by object distance is v1. This is equal to mu1 minus mu2 divided by what? R2 or minus R2? Why plus R2? No, R2 is like this only, right? So this is R2. But it is plus R2 only. You are not using sign convention. Have you used sign convention? would have been minus R2. But you are not using sign convention. Why? Because they are variables. Once you know the values, suppose R2 is 10 centimeter, then you put value of R2 as minus 10. But when you're keeping it as a variable, you'll keep it as R2 only. Okay? Because the lens need not be like this. Lens can be, you know, like this also. So then you'll say minus R2. Sorry, plus R2. Right now you're saying minus R2. Right? So I'll use sign convention when I'm putting the value of R1. Sorry, value of radius. Okay? So let us put this as R2. Now when you add these two equations, what do you get? This is 0. Isn't it? And when you add, this thing will go away. Any doubt? So you will get mu 1 by V is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1, 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. What is V? V is F. That's how focal length is defined. Isn't it? So I can say that 1 by F is equal to mu 2 minus mu 1 divided by mu 1 multiplied by 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. Okay? So basically, left hand side is the effect and right hand side is the cause. Fine? Alright? So you got a relation between cause and effect. How much refractive index or how much radius of curvature will cause how much deviation? Something like that, you got the relation here. Fine? Okay? And that effect is quantified as focal length. So basically, you have defined focal length in terms of radius of curvature and refractive index. Okay? Fine? Now for fixed R1 and R2, if you fix R1 and R2, what will happen? This bracket thing becomes constant. Okay? You fix R1 and R2 and you also fix mu2. You are just changing mu1. Okay? So if mu1 is less than mu2, F will have some sign, plus or minus. Okay? And if you then increase mu1 to more than mu2, F will change the sign. Okay? So just by changing the refractive index of the surrounding, you are able to make a converging lens a diverging lens, and a diverging lens a converging lens. You are able to switch the sign of the focal length itself. Fine? So there is no direct correlation, just like you had in case of mirror. What you had in mirror? F is equal to R by 2. That kind of correlation is no longer for case of lens, because it depends on not only radius of curvature but also depends on refractive index. Not only refractive index of the lens but refractive index of the mediums also. Okay? And again I am reiterating here that our assumption is both sides of the lens have same refractive index. Okay? And that is usually true, because whatever lens you are wearing, you have both sides air only. And when you are using microscope, telescope, then also both sides have same refractive index. Okay? But if suppose there is a numerical that comes in which one side is filled with water, suppose this side is filled with water and this side is air, then you can't use all this. Then you have to use spherical interface formula. One interface, then other interface. Are you getting it? Okay? This formula is also called lens maker formula. So what we have done now is we have derived the lens maker formula. So it may come, maybe in your duties or derive lens maker formula. What is the lens maker formula? It basically relates focal length with the parameters of the lens. Fine. Now let us derive lens formula. We'll derive lens formula, then we'll take a few numericals. The previous one was Lenz Maker formula. This one is Lenz formula. You might have already learned about Lenz formula in class 10. 1 by V minus 1 by U is equal to 1 by F. Okay, we are going to derive it now. So draw a lens like this. This is the principal axis. This R1 radius, R2 radius, okay? And then suppose you have an object here. Okay? This is reflective index mu1, and of course that is also mu1, and this is mu2. Okay? Try to use spherical interface formula and write two equations. You don't need to solve them, just write down the two equations. Okay? Okay, so this is the spherical interface formula. Okay, fine. Now object distance will be given usually. So I'll assume that to be u. Okay, so what is n2 for the first interface? Mu2. And first image let us say is v1. I don't know where it is. And I am not even interested in v1. It is just an intermediate image. That is an object of second interface. Okay, so mu2 by v1 minus mu1 by u is equal to what? Mu2 minus mu1 by r. This is for the first interface. Okay, is this thing clear? Now what is for the second interface? N2 is what? Mu1 divided by final image minus n1 is mu2. So mu2 divided by object, which is v1. Image of the first is the object of second. Okay? This is equal to mu1 minus mu2 divided by r2. This is r1. So you have first interface 2 like this. Getting it? Now you add these two equations. When you add it, this 2 will go away. Okay? So you are left with mu1 by v minus mu1 by u is equal to mu2 minus mu1 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. This is what you get. Okay? So 1 by v minus 1 by u is equal to mu2 minus mu1 divided by mu1 into 1 by r1 minus 1 by r2. Now what is this right hand side? Is it 1 by f? Right? So we have derived the Lenz formula 1 by v minus 1 by u equals to 1 by f. Okay? Sign convention for this remains exactly same that you have followed for the mirror. Getting it? So you got a formula for horizontal distances along the principal axis. Any doubt? Fine. So this is for horizontal distances. Write down. Now we try to find out formula for vertical distances, and formula for vertical distances takes, you know, that there we will try to find out through magnification. Okay, so if you know that image will be here, if you know exactly image will be here, then how many rays you should know, you should have to locate the image? Only one. You already know here will be the image somewhere along this line. You just need to know one ray. Wherever it intersects this line, that is the image. Are you getting it? If you don't know where is the image, then you need two lines and their point of intersection is the image. But wherever is the image, it should be along this line
and one line if you pass through the optical center, it will go undeviated. That's how we take in case of lens, that a ray that passes through the optical center goes undeviated. Okay, fine. Actually, in real case scenario, it will be slightly shifted, but then we assume that the lens is very thin. So there is an assumption, because of that we can say that light ray that passes through optical center goes straight. Any doubt on this? Okay, let us say this is P, this is Q, this is R, S and T. Do you see any similar triangle? This triangle and that triangle, they are similar. So I can use ratio of sides. Why I am using ratio of sides? Because this and that, they are what? Object and image distance. This I am anyway getting from here. So in terms of horizontal distances, I will try to find vertical distances. Okay? Let us say height of object is h4 and height of image is h5. So I can say that hi divided by ho is equal to qs divided by pq. Is this correct? Fine. Now it need not be that always when inverted image gets formed, it could be that erect image gets formed. So I need to consider a sign convention here also to have a generalized this thing. So when I write hi, I will use it as minus, because I have to assume upward as positive, then downward becomes negative. If one is positive, other becomes negative. So with sign convention I can write height. Okay, and with sign convention I will write value of qs also. If qs is V, so it is V, PQ with sine convention becomes minus U. Okay, so HI by HO will become equal to V by U, and this is what the magnification formula is. Magnification in case of mirror was what? Minus V by U. In case of lens it is plus V by U. Okay, so we have got a formula for horizontal distances, and this takes care of vertical distances. Any doubt? Fine, all sides for numericals.